Hello and welcome back. If you follow the channel, you know that we just restored an HP 106B high stability quartz oscillator. It is meant to drive our HP 115BR divider and clock, an instrument that was famously used in the 1964 flying clock experiment to synchronize the world's atomic clocks for the first time in history. With both of these working, it's now time to reunite them, then start and synchronize the clock to atomic time, which is a whole complicated affair. The final moment when we reunite those two that are made to work with each other. Can you look at the back? Man, this is so heavy. They have the same connectors for power, so the 24 volts comes out of this connector. I found it, fortunately. It's a military connector that's still made. And that's the male and the female goes in there. There you go. So I have to make a cable, connect those two, then I put the 100 kHz from here to over here. And theoretically, we should have a high precision clock. So this one is this guy. So the complicated procedure to get the clock started goes as follows. You open it up. There we go.
Hello.
Hi, Mike.
How's it going?
I'm going good. You're going to witness the complicated procedure to set up my new clock.
Oh boy.
There's a whole write-up right on here. You just follow all those instructions. If you look inside, it's made like a tube instrument.
Oh, wow.
And then the people have just met their first transistor in their life and it's too small, so they put it in a big thing to make it bigger so they can handle it. All right, so you've set it, so at least it's correct here, but if I had to set it up, I would have to move this and change that, but it's actually 11. There we go. I'm going to get our time. Because I'm doing the wrong wheel. 18, there we go. I'm going to do 20. And then you get it started. First divider. Got 10 kilohertz, second divider, got 1 kilohertz. Synchronous motor? Okay. 4, 2, 5. I do not demonstrate it well here, but at the left there is a wheel with a locking peg that you can pull out. Advancing or retarding that wheel by one locking position will move you by 1 second exactly, which makes adjustment of the seconds relatively easy.
Approximately good, and then you get a tick from the worldwide radio or whatever the Colorado atomic clock, and you put it on an oscilloscope. This thing gives you a tick precisely in microsecond, and you get that going. I won't put the cover on because I want to change it. Put it on the atomic clock. There you go. So now we are going to try to use the fine control to synchronize the two. So unfortunately my cesium clock doesn't have a divider for the one pulse per second thingy. So I have to use this thing with the external clock input.
So what you're looking at the bottom of the stack is an HP 5061A, a portable cesium atomic clock. I have several episodes about us getting it going that also explain the fascinating quantum physics happening inside. It was first introduced by HP in the 1960s, a horological revolution at a time when atomic clocks would occupy a whole room. The HP clocks are still produced today under the Microchip brand. They call it the Microchip 5071A, but you can tell it's just a rebadge HP 5071A. Here is how it used to look, with proper attribution. It's, of course, the successor to our HP 5061A, based on the same cesium tube which Microchip is still producing today. HP technology is still going strong after 60 years. My cesium reference is not equipped with the optional 1 second tick generator, so I use an HP 59308A timing generator instead, which I drive with the cesium using the external reference input. As HP says in their 1974 application note, if you happen to have an atomic clock lying around in the lab, just use that. Okay, if you insist, we'll use it as Bill and Dave intended.
I set it to a pacer of 1 to the 6 millisecond, which is 1 second. It does me a very small pulse, which I have here on the left. So that's the cesium clock every second. The big one is the pulse generated by the crazy circuit on that. And we have it pretty close. Eric did a lot of cranking to get it to 32 milliseconds. You want to adjust it to its ultimate position. So you see this play, so it's coming. Can I switch you for a second? There you go. 20 microseconds. 10 microseconds. It's supposed to be adjustable up to 1 microsecond. 5 microsecond. And now we are 1 microsecond. There you go. You got that. So now we have the two clocks synchronized. Center. There you go. And you can see that the cesium and the quartz are to the first order, indicating the same thing. And then we ended up with a, what is that? 132 milliseconds, 492 microseconds. Yeah, it really does its microsecond thing. You can probably get half of that. And then you can compare the clock drifts. Don't you imagine you have another clock with that, and you can let it run for a year and figure out how many microseconds you got off. So that's the whole point of this clock.
Nice, but what if you don't have an atomic clock laying around? Well, the 115BR raison d'être is actually this latter case. It was meant to be synced to the WWV radio signal from NIST at Fort Collins, which had the best atomic clock in the nation. However, because of the radio propagation and the slow rising audio tone, the synchronization can't be as accurate as we did here. Let us demonstrate.
But what if you don't have an atomic clock? Then you would use this setup, which is what it was meant to be originally, to sync it to the Fort Collins signal. I don't have 1960s radio, but I have a 1950s one that kind of sort of works. It's not been restored yet, so it's an R388. And so over here I have the tick that's driving the scope, and I put the tick at the beginning right here. We can see it, I hope. And then you have the noise from the receiver at this moment. And I'll tune it to WWV.
2021. NIST will be broadcasting a test signal on minute 8 of each hour on WWV and minute 48 on WWVH.
So unfortunately, the AGC doesn't work here, so I'll have to tune it.
And is a joint effort of the Ham Radio Citizen Science Investigation.
They're very talkative. But you can see the tick over here, or the beep, or the talk, whatever you call it, and I'm within
what is that? I would say 20 milliseconds, well, more than that. 20-25 milliseconds of it. I already cranked a lot. So we're approximately right, and now we're going to make it perfectly right. And you'll quickly see why this is the atomic clock version here. It's for this kind of signal or this kind of sync, it's just way too much turning, and I've turned it for 15 minutes already, so I'm close, and you can see how it moves over here. Okay, yeah, this is annoying, so I'll make this one bigger. Nope, I'm doing it the wrong way. Oh, it's fading out. Come back. Okay, so we'll continue to move it. And you can already see the problems, right? It's fading in and out, although we're at night, it's getting pretty late. Okay, so now I am towards the beginning. Since the automatic gain control doesn't work on this, I need to continually adjust it. And okay, so now we're starting to get closer. Okay, and now you see the problem. So yeah, where does it start? Where does it end? So you see my tick over here. I'll try to align it a little bit better with the graduation, at least from where I'm looking at. I'm pretty good. But no, it's the form. It starts before, after, depending on the transmission delay, goes in and out, and so it's hard to do it to better than, yeah, I mean, couple, I would say the hundredth of a second. So I get all mixed up in my units for a moment here, but as you can see, you get about 10 microsecond resolution with this method. Which is why the original resolution of an unmodified 115BR was also 10 microsecond, so you wouldn't have to crank like crazy like I'm doing here on the upgraded 1 microsecond clock. Right. Which is 100. Okay, it's actually 100 of millisecond, you can do it. But that's how you would do it in the time. That's how you would synchronize your clock to the Fort Collins time tick.
At the dawn, 7 hours, 16 minutes. Coordinated universal time.